Welcome, everyone. Let's make a start with the fourth lecture in our series, English series, monthly. And we think it's a very important start that our lectures are now also in English for all the people on the internet, because there are also many people listening now and for you. So that's a big point. There we come. Welcome, and you are here now, the guest of the Theosophical Society Point Loma, The Hague. Or you may also say our foundation, the International Study Center for Independent Search of Truth. And before I start my lecture, I give you a little bit information about what you may expect. The lecture is divided in three parts, and after each part, it is your turn to speak, to ask questions that we can discuss it. There will also be one pause, so about 3 o'clock. So I will look at it, that it is about 3 o'clock, and then you can get something to drink and talk with all the people here at the books, at the folders, and about the courses. And then we will close the lecture about 4:15. And when you leave the room, you will get the opportunity to make a financial contribution. If you think our public lectures are worthwhile, then you can do it, but it is of course completely voluntary. It makes it possible for us to continue our work, and you can understand all your money is also spent on our work, because we only have volunteers, so there is no one paid here. So time to start. So I push on the B button, and there we are. Compassion and responsibility, standing above matter, yet in the midst of the society. Really a challenge. One of the biggest challenges. Why the subject? Well, it is one of our key thoughts, the idea of compassion and responsibility. One of our 7 jewels of wisdom, which is, you may call it a symbolic way of talking about those key thoughts of the theosophy, or you may call it also the universal wisdom. And of course, these are life questions, so important for everyone. There are so many questions around this. What is the purpose of life? Well, young people, old people, everyone has this question. What does it mean to live unselfishly in the present world? Yeah. What kind of picture can you build about it? That will help you to make it true. And what is the destiny of humanity? What are the possibilities in our consciousness, in our human nature? And that is also a very important point. This lecture. Well, 3 parts. What is compassion, of course? I need a few words. Perhaps you already know it innerly, but I need a few words, yeah? And then we can discuss. 2, are we able to live compassionately while standing in the midst of society? And 3rd part, why should we want to grow spiritually? You will hear there is an inner path of growth, but what is our reason to do it? Yeah, what is our motive? And well, that is all about one of those 7 jewels, and we call it the wisdom of the 2 paths, which is one of the highest, that one. Okay, but This is part of a series of lectures. And our first lecture, which you can, when you have not been there, which you can see and hear it at our website, is about what is Theosophia. What is Theosophia? Well, I say a few words. It is, you may call it a wisdom religion, and it's not a creed. It has been studied and taught by, in fact, all sages of the world and all people searching for truth in all cultures. Interesting point. Well, theosophy needs no creeds or dogmas, as all its aspects, all its ideas can be examined. You may ascertain it, you may test it. Perhaps it takes a while or 10 lives, but you can it. Yeah, you are able to do it. If it is really a formulation of the laws of being, of the source and future, of cosmos and man, then it should work out everywhere and always. And these laws should show themselves also in our own circle of human experience. So within your field of testing and knowledge. Well, we always are glad to tell it, because it has, of course, no value if you would believe us blindly. Now, well, I do not expect someone of you to believe us blindly, because usually we attract independently thinking people. So, but we'll say it to stress it. Second and third lecture, well, that was about an impressive series of important ideas about reincarnation, karma, hierarchies, self-becoming, progressive evolution. These are keywords with enormous amount of thoughts around it. But these five jewels of wisdom, they all describe the path of inner growth. And that means by inner growth that we not grow by getting things from outside inside, but we develop ourselves. Well, for a real step-to-step explanation, please listen to these lectures. But yet, it is a good point to have a little sketchy idea. Well, one very important thing. When you think about theosophy, think about this. Our main thought is that everything which exists is something which lives, which is conscious. So, in our eyes, there is not something like dead matter. Yeah? Even an atom is an entity with a very small body. We, of course, ourselves are entities. The cosmos is an entity. Strangely, if you hear it for the first time, but it is our, you may call, first thought. And the whole thing is based on it. But it is an important thing. All those entities, you, me, but also planet Earth, are engaged in a path of evolution. And what do we mean? We mean that, in fact, we, from our inner possibilities, evolve, flow out all our endless, you may call, capacities. So it is not an evolving, like, learning facts, but it is an awakening of what is already in us. Why? Because as a living being, we are, you can say, children or rays or drops of the universal life. And that universal life is endless, boundless. So we have, and that means every being has, in fact, as a source, as deepest source, as our deepest, now you call core, the boundlessness. Very special idea. That, in fact, in our deepest, yeah, you can say identity, we are that boundless life, but now expressing somewhat from it. But we have much more in us. So, it is a path of inner growth to try and to attempt to become more and more human now. We are now in the school of human evolution, and after that even more and greater divine possibilities, etc. Now is the point, there is a path of inner growth, but where, why should we do it? Why would we strive for it while evolving? And the last lecture, that is after a month, and that is about the knowledge of our self, and that is that inner core. It is also a very interesting lecture, it will be, I am sure. It has 1001 applications, the idea of the knowledge of ourself, and that will be also applied to the esoteric origin of human rights. So I think very interesting. Well, what is compassion? What do we mean it? And with we try to voice what the teachers of humanity say, so what in fact Gautama the Buddha, Jesus, Plato says about it. Because they agree, they have the same inner message. Well, you see, there is a lot of confusion about compassion, and we can understand it. People talk a lot about it, and that means usually that they have fake ideas. This one means this, the other person means completely something different, but they talk with the same word. I think you know how it well goes. People talk about pity, charity, and well, in our eyes, there are completely different things behind these. Now, we start immediately with the big thing. What is the idea from the theosophy? That is this. Compassion is an insight. It is really a deep knowledge of the, you may call the deepest characteristic of the cosmos, and that is unity. That you recognize that behind everything is a unity. And that means that you are, in all cases, interconnected, not only with your neighbors, not only with your colleagues, not only with, go on, with all humanity and the animals of our earth, the minerals, the divine beings of our earth, we are connected with them. And you may go and go and go further and further away. And in fact, we say there will be never a kind of barrier of moment that it will stop. It is really a universal brotherhood, a universal interconnectedness. Now, this is so principle, but it is also, when you understand it, such an inspiring thing for the little things of life, that yeah, we very like to give these lectures. Well, what means expression? What means compassion when we human beings express it in our lives? Well, I think it gives us the eye, the inner eye, to understand the problems that other beings experience. And in the same time, and that is the challenge, without being overwhelmed or even influenced, that would be ideal, by their emotions, their problems, and their wishes, and whatever are, yeah, you may call, the things which are for them just a problem. you can easily understand that challenge, that's the point. When you are able to see what really happens and to see the problems, but you keep cool and keep all your capacities alive and awakened, then you can help. Yeah, you can help the best. Sometimes we say, compare it to a physician at the first aid department of a hospital. Now, when you come there and you're bleeding on everywhere, you hope to meet a physician which is not overwhelmed by your pain, by your emotions, but you hope that you will find there someone who is, who keeps his head calm and say, okay, what is going on here? Yeah, what is the source? What can I do? And now, that helps. But this is one example. You can have so many examples. For instance, you are a parent. You take some of your children over a busy street, and then suddenly you realize that you didn't saw a kind of car which is approaching very quickly. Well, at such moments, you are the responsible person. Well, what do you try to keep you cool? To think, okay, must I go forward or backwards? So it is, eh? What is the quickest way to the safe point? Now, you look around, you do, and then when you are safe, your children, then all the emotions come. That was really a nasty thing. But that is no problem, because at that moment, your focus on, in fact, on compassion, which is a really universal above your emotions, gives you the strength to really stand above your own emotions. Yeah, it's many, many other things. It is not so easy. May I give a third example? Because it gives a good idea of compassion. It may be that you have kind of view, of better view, in your work or in your family. Let's take the work. And you see that in your organization, there is something, a kind of habit, stealing in. And that habit will surely make real problems later on. You see it. You see, in fact, that there is a kind of slackness or a kind of lack of maybe everything, but it may become disastrous. Perhaps you will have disappointed people or whatever. Yes, at that moment, of course, you feel responsibility to say it as quick as possible, because you know, when I say nothing, okay, everything it goes peacefully further, but the problems would grow. It is just like economic crisis. When people try to address the problems as quick as possible, it would be best. And, well, you try it, and at that moment, it may be that some colleagues of you are not waiting for this idea, for the simple reason that everything went smoothly. And now you come and say, that there is really something wrong. That's it. At the first sight, it may give a reaction from, are you sure? Why? Yeah? I mean, many people do not like so much to change their habits. So then it is compassion to not ask yourself, what will be the consequences? I think it's my duty, we'll see what happens. But it is real challenge, yeah. And you know, some people who try it sometimes have really a tough time. Why is compassion, you may call it an insight, an intuition? Well, it is in fact a recognition. And what recognition? That all countless entities are identical in the deepest core to universal life. So that means a lot. Because that means that if you talk about fellow humans, or even animals, or whatever, they are essentially equal. Yeah? The same value. It doesn't matter what their forms are, the outer forms. It doesn't matter even if they are far evolved or not far evolved. It's a question of time. Evolving is a question of time. It's just the same as in a normal, harmonious family. A baby is equal to a child of 12, but it needs different things. You will have more a protected way of treating your little baby, but they are equal. Of course, after 10 years, the baby has grown into a child of 12, and after 10 years, it has been a grown-up. All equal persons. And so it is also in the great nature that there should never be any, you may call a privilege or idea of being higher of those persons who have more capacities than other ones. Value is the same. And you are connected. That's something which we read each day in the newspapers, that we are connected, that all things which we do have their results and they come back to us, early or late. But yet, for many people, it is not a principle. So they recognize it, they see it, but they do not make the step, well, perhaps this is always so. And that's also the teaching of karma, the teaching of cause and effect, that in the unity, everything we do has its effects on other beings, and everything we do, good, bad, indifferent, will have its exactly the same results, which you may say go back to us, as a principle. So no exceptions. Like the cells in the body. Well, cells in the body, if you can imagine that we are a kind of cell in a big body, then, for instance, the whole idea of interest groups in our society, it is very often that people gather and form interest groups because they try to have a better life for their group. And sometimes it may be a kind of, you may say, interesting for us to know, because those interests may be, you may call, neglected. So that's important. But the whole idea of an interest group is something strange, because all those interest groups need each other. And there is only one thing, one solution, is that you think about the common good. So you must try to put your own interests as a kind of part, living part of the whole body. And, that gives an open-mindedness, which will be able to solve many, many fights and competitions. So their well-being and our well-being is coupled. You may even compare this idea, the idea of that in humanity our own progress is coupled to the progress of other people, and the progress of other people is coupled with us, that in fact we are, you may call, a kind of group of people who is trying together to walk a difficult path through the mountains, and we try to reach the goal together. Yeah? Everyone, take everyone with you. That idea you may also compare to skating. You know the team pursuit? Yeah, that's a team of three skaters and another team. And those three skaters try to be as speedily as it possible. But the point is, the skater which comes to the finish the last, That is the time that is clocked, yeah? So you help each other as team. And in a certain way, when you forget the competition, but you think about humanity, it is comparable, yeah? So that means a lot, because that means that it is never enough to only think about your own spiritual progress. That can never be enough. What is compassion? Compassion, serving the spiritual welfare of all beings without expecting any personal reward, drawing no limits to our love. Real compassion is universal. And in that case, it is something which is so natural, you do not expect any reward. Well, that's a big step when you compare to what we usually see around us. People give love in the hope to get love, yes? But this is something different, and that's why we stress it. Because this is from our, you may call, deepest motives. We draw no limits to our love. And that is also the big difference with, for instance, falling in love, yes? Because we all know what it is, but it is limited, yeah? And usually the feelings disappear, and when you have a good relation, something else appears, which is something higher, a kind of really loyalty to each other, yeah? And then you go above those limitations. Wow, and then we come to pity. What is pity? We all know also pity, because it's a part of our nature. When someone is sad, we can feel the sadness too. It reflects on us. Our antenna goes on trembling, and it is also, yeah, something very natural, resonating with the emotions of other people. But it is limited in scope. And go to the point. Ah, yeah, we will return. That's it. We will return to it in a few moments. Now, I'll give you a little idea about the source of compassion, according to the theosophical ideas of what a human being is. Well, we have, this is done the Sanskrit words, but do not try to get them in your head. Where that's not the point. But we say that you, as a human being, are not only your body. You are, in fact, you are a body, stula sharira, but it's your most outermost part. You are much more. And in fact, we are children of a boundless principle. But our most highest core, that we can call Atman. And when we have a glimpse of that kind of consciousness, then we feel a unity with all and everything, with whole nature. Now, for me, it's very rare, but sometimes you can have such an inspiring experience. Yeah, it is a unity experience. Bodhi means that we have the capacity to understand inner causes, the things, the causes behind the outer forms. And then we come to reincarnation, karma, and all those other jewels of wisdom, which are telling us about that. Really understanding how cosmos works. Manas, intellect, also useful to work it out, our ideals, and to make a useful plan. Karma, also very useful, our desire principle. We wish to reach, attain something. That is really the motor, the engine, how you call it, the drive behind everything we do. Desire principle, I say there, ideals are desires, yeah? That is desires which are based on insight. But you have also very personal wishes, very limited desires, very, may I say, stupid desires, yeah? Which are cruel even. So you have an enormous difference. Yeah. Well, there's the vitality, there is also our part which feels, and we all already mentioned it, our personal emotions, and we have our body. And, well, we think that the compassion where we talk about is the Atman and the Buddhi, the highest two. The basis is unity. And but that unity, we already give form in a kind of understanding how everything is linked together. So, and that is Buddhi. So those two, I think, are the real source, and it is a lasting source, because the first three are really our intransient, everlasting parts. That is our reincarnating part, that which we are and which we will be in next lives, and which we were in the past, the very past. Okay, well, H.P. Blavatsky, for us very important, is the founder of this theosophical movement, have written, or in fact he had quoted from very old sources, a book, The Voice of the Silence. Now that is one of our great books about compassion. And if you are really searching for more truth and finding an idea of compassion, read this book. And she says in this book, compassion is not a quality that you develop, but it is the law of laws. So it is the basis of the cosmos. And that's very interesting, the basis of the cosmos. Why? Everything lives. We say a galaxy is a living being, a divine, very, very divine entity, but how many solar systems are in a galaxy? All living beings, planets within a solar system, and how many inhabitants are, well, living in a planet? Now, you can go on and go on, but when you try to imagine how big this picture is, how we live in other beings and how we are important for other beings who are dependent from us, then you see something beautiful. Very simple, no entity can live without all the others. And yeah, we give some courses, also the course Thinking Differently, and sometimes we ask to our students, well, okay, come with an example. Can you have an example to show us, to prove that you can isolate an entity 100%. Can you go somewhere in the cosmos 100% isolated with no connections? Well, we hope to hear the first example. Well, check it. Okay, but it is another thing than pity. And as said, pity means being sad among sad people, fearful among frightened people. It is temporary. Yeah. It goes. It comes and goes. Usually you don't have much control on it. It is limited. In fact, you are looking at the outside. When someone is sad, you don't know the reason. And sometimes there is a lot of going on, and sometimes it is only something that he needs some quietness. He needs to think something about. Yeah? You see, it may be very, very different. You look to the outside of the problem. You don't have any clue to the causes. And it doesn't help you to give real help. If a child is really crying, shouting, now every parent knows, sometimes I must listen to it, sometimes I must sure not listen to it. It will be a very good lesson. Yeah, okay. If you want to shout, you may go away, and please come again when you are, in harmony again, or another solution. Yeah, the best solution you can think about. And yet pity has its role. It's a warning bell. Yeah, if you feel somewhere, hey, here there are tensions, that may be a good warning bell. Yeah, there are people are busy with something and there is something not clear. Okay, oh, the arrow has sunken, but it should be the feelings, yes, but we already saw. Yeah, completely other aspect, yes? Okay, a few things yet. Compassion, we say, the gift is, it's an attitude. So it is also not sometimes doing something charitable, yeah? You know all the possibilities. We see all the illnesses that you can get. Nowadays you come around and all those illnesses have a week where you can put some money in it. Well, that is of course doing charitable things, but that's not exactly what we mean. And because the interconnectedness is always a fact. So it is a kind of looking to the world. It's an attitude. And you must realize that if more people try to live, to express, in fact, their deepest idea, that we stop with island thinking and stop with the idea of, I'm a little bit a privileged group, yes, somehow. And then you may have 101 reasons, but we all always say, think again, is it true? The illusions of our personality, which means our lower ideas, yeah? And really, island thinking is the great cause of really all problems you see in the world. Every problem, yeah? Island thinking in religions, island thinking in races, island thinking, go on. Yeah? Producing really all disharmony, tensions, and conflicts. So it is basic. And, well, perhaps if we, in our lectures, can give all the people in Holland to start with, or we are now internationally, and all the people in the other countries now listening, that idea that ethics is not an invention of us people to make things a little bit smoother. It is really founded in the universe itself. If people really know that, have tested it, well, the world changes. Yeah? And at last, animals, you may ask yourself, okay, we are talking about how compassion works out in us, human beings, in our human school of life, learning to think because we are thinkers. Animals do not think yet. They are in one step lower in the big path of evolution. And yet, does compassion express itself in animals at their level? Very interesting. Yes, as rare expressions, we see it, yeah? And on the internet, you have some nice videos of animals protecting animals of another species. I give you one little example from a gorilla, big ape, in a zoo in Holland. And that gorilla found a little bird with a wounded wing. Well, he put the bird in his hand. He said, hey, this bird cannot fly away. Well, what did the gorilla? He climbed in a tree and he tried to stimulate the bird. Well, you can do it, fly away. Well, that didn't help. He missed the manas, the intellect, in fact, to translate his compassion to a good plan. Yeah, he missed it, of course, he couldn't. But these are really expressions. Why rare? Well, their instincts, they have no responsible self-consciousness, have not yet evolved to the emotional universal aspects. And we say, when humanity evolves to a more humane humanity, we will take with us the animals. We will inspire them to evolve their very, how may I call it, universal instincts. They are there. And we have one example, at least one, is the bees. Study the bees and become wise, yeah? About. Okay. Your questions. Because I told already a lot. And I hope it was a little bit understandable. You may ask about everything, about the lecture, about other things of theosophy. Yeah, Joop?
How does the compassion, which you explained, compare to the golden rule, which you find in all main streams of religion and philosophy?
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Van the question is van, okay, we know the golden rule, that do another person as what you wish that he does to you, or the negative form. And it is interesting because on the internet you find that you can, it is a part of each religion. Yeah? And on the internet you see all religions with all the examples of the golden rule. Well, I think the golden rule gives a very good, you may call, impulse to see the other as equal, but it has its limitations. And while the idea of compassion, that is an idea which is so inspiring that when we try to live according to that, we are each time trying to improve ourselves. Because each time we are really also critical of, okay, is the thing which I do, is it really helping? Did I forget a connection with another person, with another? Eh? So it gives a kind of, each time an enormous, you call it inspiring influence, while the golden rule is a little bit based on what you think now. Your ideas of what is good are now what it is, and you say, okay, my idea is what is good, I also give it to another person. So, of course, it has a kind of very kind effect, because what you think that is your right, you say it's also the right of that person, in all cases. So there's nothing wrong with it, but the only thing you have to add is that you can grow in your understanding. And perhaps that other person knows already more than you, so not only give that other person what you wish that you will be given, but listen to him. And before you give it, it's also always very important that before you give something to people, what are their needs? And so there is a kind of I think, yet it has such a great value, the golden rule, because everyone understands it. Children of 3 years understand it. Yeah? Okay, when I play, then the other boy or girl may play too, and when I play half an hour, then the other girl may also play half an hour, etc. It works very well. Yeah.
I was just going to say with kids, because I'll be like, how would you feel if someone did that to you? And this girl, she says, well, I wouldn't mind.
Yeah, exactly. No, yeah, for instance, you say, because because for you it is something that you're standing above, or because you have a very special character. Yeah, indeed. Tell compassion means very well understanding the problems that you have overcome already. And realizing that it is reality for the person who is wrestling and trying to find it. And we already experience it, because very often when we think about the problems of another person, we seem to immediately see, oh, but he can do this, he couldn't do that. But our own problems, to get that clear, that is always 1,000 times more difficult. But the point is that you can understand that what seems to be easy for you, that it may be a real step for another person. And that's compassion. Yeah. That's why the divinities and also the masters and all the forerunners of the humanity are very much involved in what we are doing. However, they have perhaps already have all those illusions behind them. But they are very sure, because they also have the illusions. In fact, they say, we experience also illusions. We are also wrestling on our level. So we know very well what it is. But we have passed a lot of the human path that you didn't pass. And for us, that means the natural point. And that's an important point. In nature, we say, teacher and pupil is the natural way beings cooperate. When you know something more, it's your natural role or task to tell the people who still don't know it. And that's the way how nature always works. Yeah, that's it.
Do we know for sure that the golden rule should be taken literally in all these religions? Because you could focus on, okay, I would like food for myself, so the other, of course, needs food as well, but could it also be that it is like a metaphor, written as a metaphor, and it should be focused on the more inner meaning?
Okay.
So, the question is it perhaps a metaphor? It may be, but please, then you may enlighten me. because at first sight, I think it is more meant to be a daily practice, you may call instruction. Yeah, you see, many people have asked for, oh, I want to know how I can become a better man, how I became. So for many people, they are asking for a kind of list of instructions. And in a certain way, that cannot be given. Because your wisdom, you must in fact try to use your wisdom, and that is also the wisdom you gathered in former lives, and that will awaken it, grow it, then you will be busy with your wisdom, enlarging it, using it, etc., etc. And following an instruction is not so much as a kind of stimulation to really grow yourself. But yeah, somehow they had to give certain instructions because to make yourself clear. But those instructions were never meant as absolute. It was perhaps at that time, perhaps at that period, for those persons that maybe would be a kind of hint. But you must always think about it. And it is also an explanation of the many, you may call instructions about food, about whatever you find in the holy books. See it as relative. Perhaps he had a meaning, but it's not sure that you should say, okay, so we must do it too. No. Okay, Herman.
Henk, if you compare the golden rule with compassion, my feeling is that and the golden rule, you expect something from it. So if I do this,
then I can expect from other and so on.
Yeah.
But if you exercise compassion from our point of view, there is not a motivation that you have to gain something by it.
Yeah. Very good thing, I think. Yeah. So the idea is that the golden rule is a little bit, you may call it a kind of social contract from when we help each other, that would be nice.
Well, don't take me wrong, I think if we exercise it, everybody nowadays will improve the world.
Yes.
But if you compare it with the compassion definition as we use it in theosophy, then it is a little bit, let's say, lower, a little bit more selfish.
And, well, there is no reason for us not immediately to understand the real compassion. So there is, I agree, but there is no reason to have between steps in our thoughts. Every person can also understand what those real compassion is. And then you are standing really independently, because whatever the person does not influence your principles. Yeah. And this real independent way of standing in the society. I do not say it's easy. Yeah, but it's very well possible. Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
I mean, you mentioned that bees are an example for showing compassion. Yeah. Assuming, and I think that's what you told us, that compassion is sensing in a self-conscious way something, unity, the oneness.
Yeah.
So if bees are an exception, you are saying that bees are self-conscious animals?
Okay. So bees, I say, they are exception. Well, what I try to say is they express compassion, but on their animal level. And it is still instinctual, but it is, when you know a little bit about bees, but they are very intelligently doing all the things they do. They have a very intelligent way of dividing all the tasks, but it is such a cooperation that you really can say they act as one organism. And that's very typical. It really acts as one organism. And, you see it somehow in the ants, you see it somehow in other animals, but in the bees it is exceptionally clear. And theosophy says that they really have a kind of model function in animal kingdom. So for all, in fact, all insects, perhaps more animals, they are the ideal type. And you always need an ideal type to in your evolution, because we need examples. We also need examples, living examples of the things of our ideals. So they really have a kind of, you may call it avatar, they bring something really universal in the insect kingdom, in the insect group.
It's still an instinct, so not self-conscious.
Still an instinct. Yet we always see that instincts are very often much more intelligent than what we, with our self-consciousness, can understand or can... So that's very strange, but it's true, yeah? And so that is also something to think about. How is that possible? Yet there comes a moment that in our evolution, we will have evolved our thinking so much that we will be acting in the same way as bees, but completely self-conscious and acting very independently, yeah?
So could you say that bees are at their level, animal level, further developed than human beings at their thinking level?
Okay, question is whether the bees are kind of on their level or more evolved than, well, then you say than human beings on their level. It depends on the human being. Yes, because happily we have also a kind of bees in human form. Very interestingly, Astrid had a question about metaphors, but you can find the bee also in holy books, and it does not only mean the bee, but it also means the pupil of a spiritual teacher. So when you are learning to be a real, getting a real spiritual life, they called those persons bees. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And it's very interesting. Yeah?
Is it possible to have compassion for something that you don't understand?
Ah, yes.
Question is, you don't understand something. Can you feel compassion with it? I think the effect of compassion is that you very quickly after that realization, you will gain that understanding. So your compassion is there. That may be 24 hours, 7 days a week. There is something which you do not understand. So at that moment for you, you can do nothing. But typically for people who are a little bit, who are not indifferent, but who are thinking, I want to know. And it is the attitude, and then you will learn very quickly. Yeah?
I will rephrase. Can we be compassionate towards the universe?
Yeah. Or for instance, to divine beings, which is also very difficult to say. What are they doing, or what are they busy with? Yes, or the universe, even higher cosmic beings. I think we can, but may I have a little guess? When you talk to a cosmic being, you say, "Okay, what must I do to be compassionate to you?" What do you think he answers? I think he answers, "Try to be a compassionate human being, and then you do your best." There's a golden rule. When beings do their best, they do all they can, and that is the harmonious situation. Harmonious situation is not a situation where we do not learn, where we do not make faults, no, where there is not a lot of things to do and to solve, no. That's harmonious situation is everyone does his best. And it doesn't matter on what's playing. I think it's something very interesting. Yet, your question is really relevant because we really have a responsibility to the higher beings. When we are very tardy and very, you can also call lazy in learning, those higher beings are, you may call, also retarded, because they have the oath, they have decided to wait until we have made a kind of step, and what do we do has really influence on what they can do. So there is a really interconnection. Can you see a little bit? Of course, they will not complain, but yeah.
Yes, I would say, I think about this book of Plato, Politeia, where he describes this ideal society, where everybody does exactly that what he is good in, at, and he gets no reward for it, but he just brings it in to contribute.
Yeah.
And I think that is, maybe he does not understand where it's goal is, or what is the effect, so he does not see what your question is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
The whole picture, but he gives what he can on every level, and I think that is compassion.
Yeah, you think so? We call it the hierarchical cooperation between beings. Well, hierarchies, that has a negative tone, that word. But we mean something quite different, and that is what you say. That everyone on his level has his own contribution. And then it works. We also say when the Buddha works well, and the man who is spreading the letters to, what do you call? Doesn't matter what kind of job. When they all work together, we have harmonious society. But Plato was really one of the teachers who gave the same universal ideas, true, like Muhammad, like Jesus. Pray too. Okay, perhaps time to pause. True, we pause. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's make a start with the second part. How does a compassionate life in the midst of society look like? And first of all, a question causes all chaos, disharmony, and fighting. It is this one, humanity, we consist of learning beings not yet fully aware that we are inextricably joined. And that is our path forward. And we told something about animals, we discussed about animals and men. But the great difference is that animals are still following instinctively the harmony of nature. We are thinking beings, and we are able, with our free will, really to make choices, either cooperating with nature or going just the opposite way. And that, you may call it now. Learning, critical learning phase of us humans, that is the situation where we now are. And this awakens our compassion, sure. Yeah. We may understand our human beings, also when they make faults, that does not mean that we say, okay, we approve it. Because it also may mean that we think, okay, this is something where we have to take action. And not to say that that person is wrong per se, but here we must try to get a step further. So it is sure not always approving. What is our society? Well, did you once ask that to yourself? What is a society or a community? And, well, you see here the theosophical idea, our society is a group of reincarnating egos, because whole humankind is much larger than the people who form one community. But they are attracted to each other. It's not a question of purposeless, haphazard gathering. Yeah, they are attracted to each other according to law and effect. And what in fact happens is that you cooperated before with those people. And you come back together as a kind of group, and you will continue that cooperation at the level where it was. Well, this is already a nice thing to know, because when in Holland there is a hobby, is to criticize, and that is to complain about all things which are going wrong. Well, when you have ever heard about this, okay, it is my own heritage. Well, then you get a completely other view. Yes, you see, okay, it has no sense to complain because it is lost energy, of course, but you knew already. But it has also much sense to bring forward alternatives. And we are, it's also our duty, yeah. It's also an answer to those persons who think that if you wish to become spiritual, you should go out of the society, on a mountain, otherwise you cannot reach it. Yeah. Well, theosophically, you must think what you're doing, yeah? Because why are you in that society? Yeah. All members have made the community as it is now, interacting in this and former lives. And now we are sowing the seeds. We are responsible for our contribution, and in fact we are now making the future. That's the interesting point. Each day we are making the future by our choices, by our ideals, etc. And that means that some of the ideals which only are partly realized are yet very forceful seeds which remain in a society. In the midst of society means knowing what is going on. Well, that sounds natural, but it's not so easy. Yeah, simply, if you think, okay, I want to know what's going on in the world, you have all kind of news. And we all know that we have to be very careful with interpreting that news, yeah? Because it is, of course, gone through other people's interpretations. So when I'm a teacher, and one of the main things we try to teach to our pupils is to interpret the things which you have on the internet, on all the chat boxes, etc. So, very important. First examining the facts and their causes, then taking action. And I think this is real a question of expressing compassion. Not take action immediately when you do not know what you are doing. Yeah? That is, then you, when you are wise, you say, okay, we take time, we must take time. And perhaps there should be a first amendment to make things not worse. But the real thing which has to be done is finding the causes. And, well, there are so many examples of that where people are quickly or emotionally reacting and making the things worse. That I can, you know so many examples, so easy. One simple one is I know from a woman who worked as in the healthcare, and she had found out that when there was a meeting and something went wrong, then she said, okay, we now can manage it very well because we have learned to say, okay, what are the facts? What was factual going wrong? And not looking to the person who did it, so not saying, okay, you did it wrong, so you must solve it. No, it's our problem. That's what can be best done. Divide the tasks. And, well, that simple, very simple idea, well, have led to good meetings. Yeah. First, next, considering our fellow men as equal contributors, always respecting the free will of all involved. And, well, that is, you may call one of the most principled, most fundamental ideas of the universal wisdom. You never go against the free will of other people. It is, yeah, you may call forbidden, no, it is a thing which when you are wise, you know, it would always work out very badly. For the simple reason, if you dwingen, force someone to do something, in fact, you neglect his own higher self, his own higher nature, his real nature as human being. You neglect it. You treat him as an animal. So that is always wrong, and it has also the same wrong effects. And this seems to be solved, but it is not the case. That is a real illusion. That is not the case. Yeah. Help people helping themselves, also an old idea, by calling, for instance, upon their treasure house of spiritual lessons. We all have much more already wisdom gathered in former lives than we perhaps use. But you can call upon the peoples and then it will come out. Yeah, look at them that way. And, oh, there are so many beautiful examples. For instance, lastly, in our last journal of Lucifer, we had the example of a jail in Uruguay, and which was not a jail anymore. I mean that Uruguay was known to be a country where the jails were really terrible. So when you come in the jail there, then you have a life which is really, really cruel, yeah? The circumstances. But in the same Uruguay, we see now that five volunteering prisoners could start a village within a city. This is a kind of village made it. And there are only a few things which they had to belove, to promise. Is they should start a real good occupation, a firm or something which was needed. They should not use drugs and they should not use violence. When they would do that, they would go back to the jail immediately. And, well, this is now going on. So it's very interesting to see it, but at the moment it's working out very well. And then you can think, okay, they only put there the people who steal, so they're only the slight... No, it's also the real, the tough guys had also the opportunity on the same principles. And so I think that is very interesting. You call upon them on something which perhaps in their life was never called upon. Yeah? They never were trusted, and now you trust them. Use differences as chances of inner growth. Seems also too so simple, but it is not so simple. But it is very, very important point. Let's take a look what I have here. It means this. It means that a compassionate society is not a sameness society. It is not a kind of quiet sleeping away your time. It is something very, very, you may call, vital and interacting. Because you know you can learn a lot of other people. And when people have that attitude, many, many things will go very quicker than now. And well, there are so many examples. Oh yeah. May I say one little example, also very current thing. Well, 1 year ago was it the great disaster of the nuclear plants in Japan in Fukushima. I think it was 1 year ago. About three people worked together, own initiative. One of them had a good knowledge of ITC. Another one about Geiger counters, the counters which measure the radioactivity, and another one about GPS, so orientation. And they were together and said, I think we can manage to make a kind of very cheap Geiger counter with an inbuilt GPS and an inbuilt chip that all the measurements we do in the streets of Japan can be immediately placed in a kind of great map. And they made such a little instrument, which was not so expensive, and made many of them. They themselves went through thousands and thousands of streets of Japan, and they managed also to get other groups very enthusiastic. The result was really great, because of course it was not the hardest, most precise measurements, but what was the need of the Japanese people at that moment? Nobody knew what was the radiation around them. Nobody knew. They say, I'm 100 miles from, but nobody knows sure. And now you have a cheap thing, and they managed to have, well, so many streets in Japan, you won't believe it, yeah? And that means that someone can say, okay, in this street of mine, it is reasonable, and my plans to move with my family to another place are not necessary. Or even, you can move to a place which is worse, yeah? Now, so this is just one example of combining those things. Okay, we go to perseverance. Working for long-term goals, realizing that people need time to reform their hearts and minds. And, the point is, you have an ideal, and when you are compassionate, do not make so much fuss about the question, will people immediately follow, yes or no? Or will I have realized that this tomorrow or next week? I mean, you can also leave it to what happens, yeah? But that's a very main thing. It is your duty, try, and go with all your strength. Now, there are examples of real reforms which start with 3 or 5 or a little group of people. They started once, had a very clear idea for what should happen, and they worked for it and worked for it. And in fact, what you see is that all changes in society start with a small group of people. So that should also give us a good idea of how things work out. It is yet a yeast. It is with yeast, I mean an idea which is working and working and working. People take that idea with their minds, you may call it from the air. They also start working. People think about it, and there comes a moment that you may see a real, common, you call resonance, and that things go then very quickly. But it starts by perseverance. And we do too. We also need time. It is a long-term thing. Compassion to animals, the same principle, giving them the opportunity to express their inner nature. Exactly the same principle, but it is an instinctual nature. And I think we can make a large improvement step with our treatment of animals. Yeah. And what it is not? What is it not? Is it soft or ineffective? Well, we think it's surely not soft and ineffective. That's really a misunderstanding. Because compassion has nothing to do with yielding to the wishes of other people. That's not compassion. Yeah? That you are a kind of instrument for everyone who wants something to reach. Now, instead, what my experience is that people who are compassionate are really the most independently thinking people in society. They really know what's going on. And so they are never an instrument until voluntarily they choose to be very active in something. Yeah. Ineffective? Well, I think we had it in the Apostles about it. When people think from their ego, from the personal ego, that is ineffective. Then they think they manage a lot, but what they reach is always something which goes away quickly and usually after problems. So it is, on the long term, very ineffective. Do we talk about an unattainable holiness? And then, yeah, Jesus-like, yeah? I mean, there is in Christianity the idea, Jesus, he said good things, but that is for the people like Buddhas and Jesuses, and that's not for normal people, yeah? Now, we say simply, why did he say it? Probably because you could do it, yeah? Yeah? It is in fact, exactly the opposite when you understand it. Exactly. Is it without joy? Now, that is also a misconception. we talk about self-conquer. Okay, yeah, self-conquer, sure. But it is certainly not that the joy disappears and all those kind of things. We think that, I talked also about in the pause with about having real joy. People are really having a joyful life when they can contribute to the society, when they can contribute to the community. That makes real joy. And that's what you all can see. That's why also we talked about elderly people, that we would, we have also the duty to make it impossible, yes? Oh, the questions. Questions about this. Yeah, inderdaad.
Compassion for animals.
Yeah.
We have animals in our households and domesticated animals. Is it good to learn them a lot, or can we better let them as they are in the wild state?
Okay. That's the question about animals, and especially the animals we keep in our homes. Yeah, and the question is from what would be wise to do? Eh? And indeed, with what you can learn from the ideas of theosophy, we really come to some principal conclusions. But we must leave it up to everyone. What does it mean for his cat? Yes, because that is a point where we cannot tread. Yeah, it's the really important that we can only give some principles. But in general, it would be ideal for an animal that he could learn in his own speed, in his own tempo, in his own way. That would be the ideal situation. And you may say a kind of wildlife life or something which approaches it. Yeah, the more you approach it, the better. But that is a kind of principle. We think that when you teach animals, you may call human things, it's a little bit too early for them. Yeah, it is like, trying to give a baby, giving him impulses which he cannot handle. So in a certain way, when you are real unselfish, so you think, okay, of course, I like my cat very much, but I really want to know, then theosophy is you may call cautious about keeping animals in your homes. Yeah? Am I saying it a little bit strategically? Yeah? Because people are so fond on their animals, and we must say that there is another aspect is that when children keep animals, they learn to care. They learn to have you call it, make them, get them everything, etc., etc. So there is another other part of the coin. But things like bioindustry, then I think there's no need to talk about this, but we all agree already that that we should pay the normal price to have animal farms where they can have a normal life. And that means a lot more than what now happens. Yeah. Okay, any other questions? Otherwise I have another. Yeah, and I go on. Why do we want to grow spiritually? And this is about the wisdom of the two paths. First of all, when we talk about the wisdom of the two paths, we talk about motives. Why do you do something? And, well, when you have seen that there is a great future lying before us, that we can express more and more of our higher nature, then we start to really consciously and with a purpose to try to become wiser and wiser. And now there is the wonderful doctrine of teaching or idea of theosophy. You can do that still with two motives. There are still two motives possible with that inner growth. Why are motives important? Well, we say that our motive is in fact the color, the taste of our thoughts. You may say the frequency. When you have a motive, and it may be selfish, but you may do a kind of act which seems to be charitable, it has the same selfish characteristic, in fact, only in the shape of a charitable action. So the real character is really our motive. And that is also the real influence we have. So in the cosmos, we have exactly the influence of our motives. So there is you cannot escape that. So they are very, very important. And well, that's also the great thing of trying to understand yourself and to have honesty to your own motives. And perhaps sometimes to change them or improve them. Yeah. So it's very important. And there are two motives to walk the path of spiritual development. Because you can do it, and that's a fact. You can do it to think, okay, when I am compassionate, when I help other people, then there comes a moment that I attain a very long bliss. And theosophy say it is true. We call it nirvana or kingdom of heaven or whatever. Yes, it is true. But you can also do it in a completely other motive to become a beneficent power in the world. So yeah, you can say it in more simple words. Okay, you think, how can we manage, as we also said, to come together as a whole humanity to the point of real wisdom, then at that moment, it's not the point to make yourself loose of humanity and to have a very quick spiritual path upwards. No, the point is, okay, how can I give help, my contribution for the whole humanity? Now, you can become, and that is the inspiring thing, a beneficent power in the world. It is possible by, in fact, expressing more and more of your own capacities. And you can become a power which cannot be removed. So that means that all, you can say, tegenstand, resistance, all resistance will not stop you in doing that. So that is a very important thing. It has consequences, the choice. There is a choice here and it has consequences. I said already that when you would go on and go on and go on the first path of bliss for yourself, and you would do that for many, many, many lives, you will come to a kind of nirvana condition, and then you cannot choose anymore. You will enter it, and at that moment you are, you may say, lost for humanity, because you come in a dream state, or in fact a much higher state, where you can have no connections anymore with the earth. Now, that means the fact that you are, yeah, you may call, not anymore a working force for humanity for a very, very, very long period. And the other consequence is that when you walk the path of compassion, that there comes a moment, helping, 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 growing, 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 that you will also be on the threshold of nirvana. It's not your purpose, but you are there. At that moment, your own character will say, okay, I'm on the threshold for nirvana. Now I have a knowledge of all the illusions of earth life. I stay. And that's exactly what the Buddhas of compassion do. They stay. And they are staying for a very, very long period. And are, in a certain way, you may call the masters of the masters. Those are the men, the human beings, who are the inspirers of our teachers, of our great teachers. And the last thought, in unselfish work, real unselfish work, we never work alone. A very fundamental idea is that unselfishness means that in fact the whole cosmos is standing behind you. It is real, really so. But I already said, when you try to express it in this world, you may have really resistances and all kinds of challenges, 101 challenges. That's true. And yet, it is those challenges and those, you may say, sharp conflicts which awaken the learning process and the awakening of more wisdom in all people. So it is the importance of keeping your principles and trying to find ways to express them in society, on each place where you are. And you are never alone. You may say you will attract people with the same ideals, and that would be always very inspiring. You will attract them, you will see them, you will recognize them, you will find them. And also, when you are unselfishly trying to solve something, what happens in your mind? You are opening a window, and that mental window is in fact a kind of antenna where you can receive, you may say, the thoughts of people who are also unselfishly working, wiser people, people from the spiritual levels, and then you make contact with that. And, well, that is of course, perhaps we are not conscious, but so it works. The choice is a current one. It's for us too. It's not a question of, well, far future. Because very often we can choose for our own development or for the needs of other people. And there are, I myself have studied biology, and there was one of our fellow students was a girl, and she started her study biology with this idea, okay, with this study, I go to Suriname. That's my birthplace. And I know that there is a great need of biological knowledge in Suriname. Very few people have it. So she was studying it that way. And for me, it was always something which I remembered. It was for me really an example. And So you can have all those examples. I have also, I think, another one. Oh yeah, oh, this is so very simple. When you have your job or you are working something in an organization, and then you see there are two kinds of people. The people who do the minimum, but they do the task well. It's done perfectly, but it's their task. And then there is the point of, okay, there's a trainee who wishes to know what is going on and to taste what it is to work here and to learn a lot, sometimes very motivated. Well, are you ready to give extra energy for the trainee? Are you ready to help your colleagues when they are in the problems? My experience is that I have also worked for a while as an information officer in a scientific circle, that the departments which were working very well were those departments where all the scientists thought about each other's studies, all of them. So the tea pauses were the most important part of the day, because they sat and they talked about each other's problems and searchings, and they all gave each other advice and were busy with each other's, now you may call researchers. And I think that is typical, yeah. They do not think about, oh, that's not my... There is a hierarchy of wisdom and compassion. There are those people have chosen for the path of compassion, and those people are in fact the source of all the great inspiring philosophies and religions of the world. And it is based on it. And they do not choose anymore. They have chosen. Their point is, how can I find the methods, the best methods, to keep on and getting, finding the ears with humanity. And well, we have a theosophical society. It's founded by H.P. Blavatsky, but she founded it, in fact, by the instructions of her teachers, which were from the hierarchy of compassion, because they knew the world was very in need of these ideas. And what is the point? Everyone who endorses the principle of universal brotherhood as a fact in nature is welcome as a member of our society, Theosophical Society Point Loma de Hague, after introductory courses. Yeah. Because we know then you can make a real choice, because then you know, okay, what does it mean? What is the value? And H.P. Blavatsky can say it also very simple. The life of altruism is not so much a high ideal as a matter of practice, in her letters. Okay, that's the thoughts which I wish to... Again, it's your turn.
Yeah.
I was reading recently about the Buddhas of compassion, and what struck me was one sentence which says that they see the truth itself, and that's why they won't be tempted by nirvana.
Yeah.
They see the truth, and I was thinking about what is the truth in the sentence, and well, maybe I thought it was that they really understand and see the compassion, the law of laws, and in a way, when you understand it, there is no other way to act different. So, is it thinking in the right direction?
It's a very good addition, I think, your idea. And that's in fact the Buddha of compassion is really understanding the unity. And he is living...
They really understand and they have vision, I think, and that's why they cannot act in the way.
Yeah, they cannot act in... if I say for many, many lives it has grown into their character. Yeah, it is here the choices. Eh? And you can say that the first person following the first path uses compassion as an instrument. And the second, for the second person, it is simply the truth. Eh? That's the big difference. And in a certain way, the first person has not overcome the main illusion, is the illusion of separateness. He did not overcome it. Although he is a very spiritual being, very strange, but it is, he has isolated himself, literally. And, well, this seems also very far away, but it is also in the little things now, where we can, yeah. We can also say, people are maybe very attached to matter things, material situations, but when you do not understand the truth completely, you can also be attached to spiritual things, attached. So you think that is the only reality, spirituality. But the real fact is that they both combined give the universe as a school of growing beings, and that both are have relative value. The matter things, relative value, and spiritual things also relative value. Now, and at that moment, when you see that, nirvana is no goal. It is even possible, and that is for us a little bit nearer, when we die, we easily are in what we call a kind of blissful dream, which we call Devachan, for a long time. So it's the normal average man is for many, many centuries in a blissful dream. Well, that's of course okay. But it is possible when you are more and more engaged with these things that that blissful period will shorten. Because you, in fact, have feel, in fact, the earth still there. And you feel, in fact, the, you call it, that's your place to work and to work, go on with your work and to continue the things which you did. So in a certain way, you are will be shortening that period. Yeah. Perhaps more questions?
Yeah. How is higher desire connected to compassion? Because it seems to be inextricably connected. Because when you feel compassionate, you want to do something.
Yeah.
And in the case of the bodhisattvas.
Yeah.
It's some kind of desire that brings them back as well.
Yeah, our question is higher desire and compassion. Yes, I think that what you say is simply 100% true. So, in fact, your motive, the bodhisattva motive, is a higher desire of the most unselfish nature. And desires are neutral in itself. You may call it a kind of universal willpower. And you are the person with your consciousness who colors it, who uses it, who directs it, and who are also responsible for it. So the bodhisattva has also his willpower and his desires, which, and that desire is, yeah, how can I serve all people and even all beings, because they learn to serve all beings. So, sure, yeah. And desires are something which all entities need. And you find also in the books about the birth of a cosmos, usually always written in metaphors, in images, But you always find the idea from where did the cosmos come from? It started from, you may call, an unknown principle. And then the first awakening of a cosmos was the awakening of the desire to manifest the things which were slumbering, in a deep slumbering, lying latent as seeds, and which were again had the cycle to come again as a cosmos and to... So that was a desire, which divine desire, which is the whole start of the whole cosmos. In a certain way, I said, I think compassion is the cement of the cosmos. That is the desire, that is the cement. That is the, which gives the real cement. You had perhaps another question about it or something?
No, I was wondering what the differences are. But how I understand it now is that desire is neutral and that you can use compassion to color it.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because compassion is also also understanding. And it is from that understanding that you color the desire and that gives the whole combination. What in fact happens is that in the what we try to be is we had that sevenfold, that seven powers in man, seven layers of consciousness. In fact, we try to evolve all in harmony. They all have their place, but the leading ones are the unity and the connectedness.
Yeah, that's why I feel desire has some... it's a bit of a strange aspect in the seven. And it looks like it's the turning point also in the two paths. When desire is higher, then you choose the second path. And when it's directed lower, you follow the first path.
Exactly.
So it's a bit of a strange...
It is a middle point, and that's true. And we are now also in our, you may call, a great evolution of the planet. We are somehow at a middle point, a little bit further than the middle point. And now desire has its greatest, manifestation, its strongest manifestation, just now in this period. And it is a very difficult period because desires... are not so easy to analyze. To be honest in yourself, what are now my purposes? That's subtle. For us, not so easy. And so, you see a lot of confusion. Yeah. Yeah. Other thing, people about it? It is a bridge. It is the point where the two now pass. Divide from the desire. And it is also, we see it also in human life. I mean, it's just one example, but the midlife crisis. I mean, when people are 40 years, 50 years, you can say their psychological, mental strength is the greatest at that moment of their life, yeah, generally speaking. And at that moment also, their desire force is greatest. But it is the turning point from, okay, perhaps you have reached certain things in your life. Is this enough? Are you satisfied with good job, with go on with all the material things? And that gives these those... Okay, well, I think we will close, and we close with the Gayatri. It is you can say, not a prayer. It's a few thoughts which call upon our own deepest self, and that deepest self is called the Golden Sun. So I go to the Gayatri. And it is called this. O thou golden sun of most excellent splendor, illumine our hearts and fill our minds, so that we, recognizing our oneness with the divinity, which is the heart of the universe, may see the pathway before our feet and tread it to those distant goals of perfection, stimulated by thine own radiant light.